And yes, I am using Keynote. I did try using SlideTech for a little while and decided that wasn't quite the same for me. And I give a lot of talks, so this has been working well. Hello. And so, okay, we'll give this a go. I'd like to thank you all for having a slot for me. I learned about this meeting about 2 weeks ago from Barbara. And there had been something on my mind I'd wanted to do along this field. So I said, ooh, I could give a paper on that. And I said, well, it's 2 weeks before the conference. There's no way they'll have a slot. And sent mails. I dashed off a title and abstract and got back, sure, we'll fit you in. And even on the day you need to be fit in, because I can't stick around, unfortunately. So all I had to do was get a travel clearance, which arrived today. and between the time I submitted the travel clearance, I work at AT&T Labs, and the time my boss said, oh yeah, that's been approved, the price for the airfare had gone up $600. So I paid almost as much money as it cost to fly from Newark to Sydney to get here today, which means I don't like to do that. I'm a pretty cheap date usually, but it means I'm flying first class out and back. I even bought one of those little power adapters for use in first class. The two legs out, the first one, the brand new first class seats didn't have any plugs for them. And for the second leg, it was broken. So I didn't get to do anything there. Anyway, United thanks you. There was no question about my flying first class, though I bought coach. It was a $1,600 seat, which is not usual. Anyway, I'm only here for a day. And this is my first tech conference since, I think, 1988. My first real paper was was at Tech when I did the permuted index for Tech some 25 years ago. I don't know if any of you use it. It's still there. You do use it? Not now. Well, so we'll get back to that in a moment. My problem was that I had learned Tech and I'd just gotten, well, learned Tech. I started using Tech. I don't know who knows it. Even Don seems a little sketchy on some of the commands. But I'd hack these things and I'd have epic battles where I just want to move this over 1M. And you add spaces and it won't do it and so on. And I'd spend 2 days fiddling with this stuff. And my problem was that the answer to my question was the string command, but I didn't know how to ask the question or find where in the tech book it was. And that's what brought me to try to do a summary of every command in the whole thing, trying to use words that made sense so that if you sort of knew the right words, you might guide you to the right thing. And I submitted it, and I guess it's still available. I don't know. It was generated on a Plan 9 operating system, which is long gone, but it could be easily resurrected if anyone cared. But what this really did was open my eyes to typography, that beautiful layout is important. Ligatures, who knew? I'd been reading for 30 years and I didn't know Fs were connected to Is. And I went back, wait a minute, can this be true? And would take some of my favorite books down and, oh yeah, look at that, they're glued together. I'd never noticed that. And so it really gave me quite an appreciation and a huge amount of humility in terms of, this is something you can try. It's like user interfaces. Everyone likes to try it, but not many are very good at it. And in fact, one of the reasons I have a Mac here. I also became a nitpicker. In my recent years, I review a lot of papers and my comments often slide into, and by the way, this layout is crazy. Quote, don't use footnotes in your books, Don. I put that in some of my reviews because a lot of people abuse them. And nowadays people are including fuzzy JPEG graphs. These are sometimes in visualization papers with 3-point font. And it's just awful. So I became a nitpicker. I went on, this was just before I went off to Bell Labs, where I learned how to be somewhat of an academic. And it served me well. I wrote a firewalls book with Steve Bellevin in 1994, you folks may have heard of. We invented a style for the book, but said, okay, Addison Wesley, have a shot at it. And Marty Rabinowitz is the typographer, or was the typographer there, and he told us how to fix things, and we did that. But despite having done the second edition and published a number of papers, I haven't done much tech since then, until about 2 weeks ago, when you folks said yes, and suddenly I had to show something, a prototype. So I have been burning the midnight oil and telling my wife, no, I don't have time to go for a walk. This program has to run by next Monday at 2 p.m. Pacific time. And I made it, but it's a much better demo now than it was yesterday at this time. So I am an early adopter. My iPad arrived, I ordered it by mail. The UPS guy arrived on the day it first appeared. He was going around Somerset County, New Jersey, handing these out to many people. And you know, here you are, yeah, I got a lot more. And I started reading it and really realized that this changes everything. It's not a big iPhone, it's not a laptop, it's something new. It's a lovely way to read a book, which means it changes the way you go to a bookstore, at least for me. When I go to a bookstore, I'll buy junk books that I know I'm going to read once. But now that I have the iPad, some books I want to own and have in treasure and have people sign and so on, and I'm going to reread them and give them to my kids. But others, like today's latest take on cosmology, I'm not going to want to read that in 20 years. That's like an old textbook. I just want to read it once. And why would I buy some pulp when I could just put it into the iPad, which I don't want to forget, you know, just put it in here and now it's ready to read in some form or another. The typography in iBook and the Kindle app on the iPad are okay. I mean, you can read it. I've read about a dozen books since late March, but they're not great. And I also thought, gosh, why would a book ever go out of print again? You just store it on disk. Well, heck, you know, the Firewalls book, the first edition is still in print, even though the second edition came out in 2003. There are people who are still buying a book that talks about TIS's toolkit. They're gone. It's decades gone, but they're still there. And I thought, gee, I'm willing to charge him $1.99 for the first edition. We could split it three ways between the publisher, the authors, and Apple. It's free money. But okay, well, I've got the tech sitting here. Is there a tech to EPUB? Is there something that'll just do this? And the answer is no. Someone said, well, you could start by hacking LaTeX to HTML, but of course what it produces is not what Marty had in mind. I was also grading papers. March is paper reading month for me. I was on three program committees, and it sure would have been nice to read some of these papers on the iPad. What I had was PDF, which I'll get to in a moment, of course. So there's this early versus late layout tension. The early layout, we all know and love. This is what I learned in the 80s. Tech runoff, if you go to the 70s, and TROF versus HTML, XML, we'll figure out at the last minute, grandma wants this font and this size, and we'll just lay it out for her. And that's how we read web pages and iBooks and that sort of stuff. But really, I want Marty to do this. I don't want grandma to do it. I don't care if she likes Garamond bold. Marty, I'm a fascist in this case. I want Marty, for large values of Marty, to figure out what looks beautiful and to present them that way. And I think the authors probably want that too. So my goals for the project, I wanted Marty to design the pages. And again, large values of Marty. Typographic fascism. Each paper needs to be laid out separately for portrait and landscape. It's a different format. This thing is sort of 1024 by 768, or like that. It actually isn't, you can't just reverse the numbers because there's a little header on the top that you want to keep, which means that's different. I do want for grandma a large type edition, and Marty knows how to make those too. So it would be nice to do this. And it'd be nice to easily port old tech documents to this so that we could all be looking at beautiful layouts on the iPad. PDF did not appear to me to be the solution. Now, given 2 weeks, I didn't do a whole lot of related work reading. So it was entirely possible this talk was going to be totally redundant, and maybe it is. PDF, as far as I'm concerned, produces pretty nice looking 8.5 by 11 or A4 papers that I print out and read. I don't want to read them on the iPad. You have to sort of scan this Fresnel lens up and down like a 1960s cataract patient. And reading in a column. Page 2 is below page 1 and you're sort of halfway up and down. That's not it. Also, it doesn't know about portrait or landscape. it doesn't know what to do the right thing, and there's no large type option. Now, I listened this morning with interest to what's happened to PDF, and maybe I'm all wrong about that. We'll get back to that, which is fine. I'm okay with that. So when to do this? Well, you can run LaTeX on the iPad. Heck, the Firewalls book runs through tech. It's 480 pages. It goes a second and a half on a modern Pentium, which is just unbelievable. If you told me that in 1985, I would have said there's no way you could lay out a book in a second and a half. The DVI to whatever obviously takes a bit longer. How about sending the DVI to the iPad for processing? That's kind of close. You'd have to have the fonts lying around and stuff, but that's doable. Or a special version of tech on the iPad. There was a paper done last year here that suggested something along these lines. It looked a little busy to me, but maybe a good way to go. Or do you just pre-compute the images? And that's the way I went. Pre-compute every image for everything grandma's going to want to ask for. That means there's a portrait version, a landscape version, a large type portrait version, and a large type landscape version, all of them laid out with separate style files. So it might be quite different. Download a bundle, and the definition of that bundle ought to be, if we like this idea, ought to be standardized somehow. And then a proof of concept iPad reader. My experience with programming iPhones and iPads is now 8 days old. I've been programming in C for 20 years, and the guys who said that it's just like C, it's just almost completely unlike C. But I have an iPad reader working. It's not Tangle and Weave, but Tangle and Weave's ugly, evil stepsister hack that makes this available to you today. But that's okay, it's proof of concept. So it's strictly proof of concept. Don't push this too far. The code is shining new. The beautiful layouts that I laid out are not quite beautiful. Again, I'm not Marty, you're Marty. You can figure it out. And some of the code wasn't working till last night. There's also the quandary when you're in a rush, you want to get a program done by next Monday. Do you just sit down? It is sort of like C. Do you just sit down and write the structs and mallocs and do the C? Or do you back off a little bit and learn how it's supposed to be done and maybe get it done? So there's this quick way that might be efficient or not. And then there's the longer way where you actually learn something. For the astronomers in the crowd, you may know that if you want to grind your own mirror, I don't know if people do this anymore, but it used to be, if you wanted to grind an 8-inch mirror and you'd never ground a mirror before, the fastest way to grind an 8-inch mirror is to grind a 6-inch mirror first and then an 8-inch mirror. You will get done before you do an 8-inch mirror. And so it's the same question of how much do you do. Also, I never was very good at tech, and what I do know is 20 years old. So if I want to change the paper size, I'm in there hacking article.sty and art10.clo and these things. And they all have this ominous stuff at the beginning saying, don't change this, go change the class generation program, which I know nothing about. I suspect there's some place I can go where I just say, change the page size to this, go, and all this magic comes out. But I didn't know that. So do I take time doing that, or do I just hack what I'm doing? It turns out it would have been much faster to know what I'm doing. I hadn't heard of the geometry package, which would have made this so much easier. Wednesday, well, I've got the iPad sort of working, so Wednesday I'll try to change this into beautiful stuff. That could have been Wednesday morning. I still have it shifted wrong, but I'm going to go back and fix it. The other problem is when research yields 1,000 blooms, finding the right bloom isn't always easy. I went first to DVI to bitmap because I wanted to generate bitmaps. I'm guessing this is pretty old and hasn't been touched for a while, but I didn't know that at the time. So I was getting black and white bitmaps. It looked a lot like the output I used to get off my Epson dot matrix printer. And that's what I was going to show you folks today because, heck, you're the Marty. You can sort of envision what it would look like. And after a day of looking at this crap, oh, by the way, all of my special, PostScript specials didn't work either. So I said, well, let's do DVI-PS because, gee, I could do anti-alias fonts and grayscale somehow. They give Ghost View enough options, and it'll probably come out looking almost as good as Apple stuff. And this is one guy in 1 week trying to compete with all of Cupertino's cleverness. And then I noticed in passing DVI-PNG, which was exactly what I wanted. And everything, it suddenly it produced trim output. It had just the options I wanted. It worked great. Wouldn't it have been nice if DVI to bitmap would say, not, this isn't the official documentation, but you don't want to be here, bozo. Go look at DVI to bitmap. That would have saved me a half a day. So I've got a demo here. How am I doing? Pretty well. What to show? Well, I thought, gosh, I'll just lay out the tech book, a nice familiar thing. And I went to the web page and had forgotten the admonition by you-know-who who says, don't print out the tech book, please. So I didn't do the tech book. Well, how about the firewalls book? Okay, started running that through it. Turns out, drops core in DVI PNG. Well, I'm in a hurry. I'm not going to go find that. I can find it. I think I know basically what it's missing. And so I've got to find a book, went to Gutenberg Project, thought of Huck Finn, and said, no, how about On the Origin of the Species? So that's what I got, OTOOTS, as I call it. And I took one of my old papers. So there's a paper and a book, just to see what it looks like. Now the demo is, I'm going to show you, is on the iPad simulator, which is on this book. I also have it loaded in here, and if you ask me afterwards, you can actually touch and fondle my iPad and try it yourself. The user interface is extremely crude because I didn't have much time, none of this swiping or clever page things, it just goes, but it gives you an idea, it's proof of concept. And so let's see, with a little luck, this is just gonna go not like that. Okay, what do I do? Well, see, I'm usually pretty good at swapping these things in and out, but not always. So come here, we want this guy, and we're going to move him over to here. Oh, I don't even know if this works in this one. So we'll give it a try. In fact, we'll start it afresh. Here we go. Simulator start. Boom. It's compiling right here. No errors. Loads up, does some initialization because it's stupid. On the Origin of the Species. And if you click on the right side, it goes to the next page. This was, I basically took the text, cleaned it briefly. Barbara, this is not a final book format. This is just Gutenberg text with a few things on it. And you can see, I got the top a little wrong. I think geometry will fix that for me. Having trouble reading it, you click at the top and you get the large type version. Okay, large type in this version is 12 point, but maybe it should be something a little bigger. And you can go through here. And chapter one, and oh my goodness, Euler's equation. Did you know that was in Origin of the Species? That is used everywhere. It just keeps showing up. You thought he was just a biologist. And what's more, I found this delight, which you will never find in the EPUB version. You go a little further, we've got Maxwell's equations and the diffusion equation. So there you go. It all just lays out. It's in grayscale. It actually, I think, I mean, you can't tell up here. I think on here it looks just as good as Apple stuff. Actually better because it's got Don laying out the paragraphs and you folks doing the rest of the stuff, sort of. And of course, I'm not sure this is going to work because I'm not sure it works on the auxiliary screen. If you go to this version, oh, look, it's laid out in two column because it's a wide screen. And, you know, you can go back to previous pages. Now, there's an interesting question. I'm in a different part of the book now. When you rotate, which one should it go to? I haven't really solved that. I do this proportional thing, but someone has to think about how that works. Anyway, so we've got, it's now landscape. I think we're a little bit beyond. See, page navigation is just clicking. You know, what do you want? It's been a week. There we go, chapter. Anyway, you get the idea. And I also have, let's switch back to vertical, which you don't have to do. I have, if you click in the middle, a paper, a regular academic paper. This one I published about 10 years ago on visualizing the internet. And it's about the right size, shows networks, nice pretty pictures. And of course, with a good reader, you'd be able to click on that picture and zoom in indefinitely and so on, because let's face it, we're not just dealing with a book here. This is something that's better. And of course, go back to landscape and, oh, well, double-sided seems to be about right for this. And you can go through and I think there are even some overfull H-boxes at the end. Oh, there was, actually there was a rendering issue there, but who cares? Oh, the vertical lines show up. So that's my demo. And you're welcome to try that. Those are the only two documents in there. There's no nice selection and download and stuff. It has the two preloaded in there and not the whole thing, but it'll give you the, it gives you the idea. Now we go down here back to our regularly scheduled. Oh, this is going to be so crude. That's going to start at the beginning again, isn't it? Oh, no. No, there it is. How about that? Okay. Cleaner than most demo switches, I think you'll agree. So zooming in on images would be nice, and video. Tappable words for dictionary, glossary, the iBook, the Apple iBook. You go and tap something, and a little dictionary option comes up, and you can look up words. I have Podcane of Mars, and I looked up three words, and none of them were in the dictionary. But they should be, and they should be hooked in with the glossary and the index, and you can imagine all this sort of thing going on. And I guess you do it with little marks in the DVI somehow interacting with it. Footnote navigation. I have Dave Barry's book in here, his latest book, and you tap on a footnote and it goes to the back, and you, so you tap on 22, you go back and you got a bunch of numbers and you read 22. And if you suddenly forget it was 22, there's no back to where I was button. You have to start at 21, 20, no, oh, 22, there, that's where I was. Footnote navigation. I'd also like to have an error code if you try to go beyond a page, and I was hoping to have Don record, nope, and just have that be the error thing. And so if, I don't think he's here at the moment, but if someone can record him saying nope, I'd like to use it for this. There are other problems. Obviously, I'm going to make geometry work real soon now. Other LaTeX styles need new sizes. It was frustrating. If you're doing letter size or A4, that's fine, but nothing in there had a paper size of iPad or iPad landscape, and it's time to put that in there. And as I say, this is not the same as this, right? Because there's a little 17 pixel band across the top. So you gotta adjust it. And I know you fuzzy people care about stuff like that. The styles can be a bit over-constrained. If you're tired of fixing over full H-boxes, imagine that now when you say go to compile your document, you not only have your regular letter size one, but you have four other layouts all complaining about sizes and layouts. This may be over-constrained, but I know we can handle it, and there are probably tools that one could put in there to do a better job. It certainly would be nice to have Kindle and Nook editions. I suspect that would be pretty easy. I don't know if they go into landscape mode or not. The new iPhone is now twice the resolution of the iPhone that I have in my pocket. One could imagine that the next iPad will do the same thing, so we'll need a high-res version of it, but we'll just look better, won't we? Page numbers when switching views, that's sort of an interesting thing. It could use a much better iPad app than my one-week-old Convective C or whatever it is attempt. So what should I do with this? Should I keep going? Is this great? Should I learn Apple programming, which is one of the reasons I did this? Do we try to get people to publish their papers in this format too? Do I get clearance from my software from AT&T? I haven't tried that yet. They're gonna say, you wanna clear what? This is not the main, or do we let the PDF folks do it? If PDF really is the answer, then the PDF reader is gonna do all this stuff sooner or later, but I'm wondering if they'll get it right. So do we fork off and do it? I don't know. Also, iTech, that's what I call the demo, iTech, get it? The iTech, this bundle of how you put things, could be a very easy gzip directory structure, would need support and definition and stuff, and we could come up with something pretty easily. So rounding third here, the permuted index, I hauled it out for my hacking this time. I looked up, I consulted it four times and it helped once. The other three, I just couldn't find the words that matched, which was my first problem with it. So I don't know if that was a successful research project, but it was good to do. This seems like a useful idea. I've actually inclined maybe to download all of the Origin of the Species to this app before I leave for my flight home and read it using my app. It certainly is a pleasant thing to do. Suggestions and feedback are welcome. Have I missed things? You know, am I wasting my time? I'm willing to put more work into this idea, though you don't want me doing the style stuff. You probably don't want me doing the Apple iPad stuff either, because someone who knows how to do this stuff can rattle it off much faster than I can. I'd love to hear what you think, and I thank you for your attention and welcome questions. And that's what the talk is about.
Thank you very much. That was fascinating.
Yeah, thanks.
Really, really entertaining.
Questions or comments?
Wait till you get the microphone.
Yes, Mike?
At the last TAG meetings in Cork, there was some behind-the-scenes discussion of how to make reflowable PDF in TAG. Reflowable PDF is the one which can change pagination if you turn it, if you change it. There was even mailing list, but the problem is that nobody was able to create the application which would work. So your approach, when you just pre-compute several sizes, we discussed, by the way, there was somebody told that this is the way. And the more I see that you are absolutely right. It's probably the good way for us to create this. So it's exactly what I would suggest you to contact Peter Flynn. Unfortunately, he is not here. He could make it because you are the person he wants to talk to.
Okay. Would someone send me email? And if you can't find me, I don't want to talk to you anyway. That's great. I think it's pretty clear that someone who's not very good at tech and not very good at Apple can do this in a week and a half, that this is not that hard to do. Yeah. Send me email telling me his name, and I'll be happy to chat with him and see what should happen. And of course, welcome other suggestions. Someone else? Yes.
I'd like to congratulate you on doing in 2 weeks what it took Wired Magazine and Adobe a couple of weeks, you know, like a couple of months to do. I don't know if you followed the Wired Magazine app.
No, I haven't.
Okay. The short story is they took an entire magazine done in InDesign, flowed it out twice, once in landscape format, once in portrait format, formatting the pages by hand for each view, stuffed all of those into image files, wrapped it up with a page directory structure, done in XML, stuffed that into an app, and sold it as an app for $2.99 a copy.
Cool.
But the problem is the magazine is 500 megs.
Well, okay, so I just did the first 20 pages of Origin of the Species. If you do the whole thing, then all the layouts put together, and it's a big pile of PNGs, comes to about 300 megabytes. This is a 64 gigabyte iPad. It's going to take a while to fill it up. And if I don't want the large type, cut that in half. So I've decided, you know, in the last 20 years, CPU speeds and disk sizes have just changed dramatically. I'm not worried about it. But also the other thing is that this was a pretty good demo. Remember, there is absolutely nothing behind the curtain. they had to make it work, and they care about their layout and so on. But you know, I don't think it's that hard, especially if you really know what you're doing.
My concern with doing bitmap images is you're going to run it up against a huge, you know, countless number of permutations of different screen sizes and proportions, and eventually you'll either run out of the energy to support them, or you'll run out of
it. It could be a problem. You might just do iPads for now. And again, the large type might, you know, switching to the large type was just my answer to grandma wanting to click a bigger font. My web pages, which I redesigned that for the first time in 15 years, use a CSS that honors grandma's font size because I've had too many web pages where I can't read them. And so I want to honor that ability. You know, it's not a bad idea, but who knows? Anyway, I think the approach is doable. It takes a while to download too. And it doesn't compress well because the PNGs are already compressed. Other questions? We've got two here. Three here. There you go. We'll do. Lots of time.
Nice. Impressive.
Oh, thank you.
Really nice. But I suggest a completely different approach.
Excellent, excellent. We have time. Let's hear it.
I don't know how much you know about HTML5, Canvas, JavaScript. My idea is simply put tech into the browser. Do it all in the browser. Let the browser render the tech file. Let it break the paragraph. We have already a hyphenation algorithm running in JavaScript. We probably already have the par builder in JavaScript. We know that we've just seen that the browser can render mathematics beautiful.
Yep.
Jonathan here has done much for web fonts, so we can use open type features probably completely, or we will live to see the day to where we can use complete open type mass in by the browser.
Yep.
So forget about bitmaps. Do it all in the browser, because then your book works on the iPad, on the iPhone, on Android even.
Yep.
Or maybe even on Nokia, so it works everywhere.
Well, so that's interesting. So I guess you want a web to JavaScript converter, because you actually want to run Tech and LaTeX in the browser, I assume, which means you're going to have all the stuff, you know, all the auxiliary files you pull in. Now, it's doable, and it doesn't take that long. And, you know, do I mind if there were a 30-second delay before I start reading a book? Maybe not. So I think that's a feasible approach, and I don't know what the right answer is. I know this seems to work right now very well, but you may be right. Also, HTML5 is still gelling, of course. So we'll see how that goes. I want multi-column. But I think that's possibly right, yeah.
I just want to second his suggestion. In fact, the origin of the species is available already on the App Store. We're using HTML5. I mean, we really have to get out of the custom of doing, you know, bitmaps and bitmaps and bitmaps, and going to a vector. You know, vector is the direction to go.
Okay, so another vote for late computation, or late computation of the early layout you've got right there. Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I was thinking about something that's kind of a compromise between the two. What could you put on the iPad, something that would do your image capture that you're doing in the background, instead of packaging the images, let the images be formed within your own app?
So it would come from the DVI files then?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that might be a good way to do it.
Well, then the resolution wouldn't matter anymore, because it would happen on whatever machine it was running on.
Well, yeah, you'd still want to have a portrait and landscape version, right? You're going to have different layouts, because you should.
Okay.
Because yeah. Marty,
right.
Yeah, you know, it's a different form factor. But it may be.
All right, so now we've had votes for all three places. And that's fine. I was raising. Maybe we should do a show of hands. Oh, I'd like to hear that.
The iPad.
No. You have to use the mic,
please. The iPad can support PDF, right? So your step of converting DVI to PNG is unnecessary if you convert to PDF instead.
If you have a PDF reader that does a good enough job, I'm hoping we will. I haven't been impressed yet.
There's still work going on there.
Right.
But I like your approach, because I favor typographic perfection over flexibility.
I think for a lot of people.
There's a big trade-off. I think there are lots of different approaches.
Should we do a show of hands? Would that be fun? We've got another comment over here.
Yeah, another possibility.
Oh, jeez. Are we going to have 5 ways to slice this chicken?
Oh, boy. Another possibility to add to the list, which is on-demand compilation, if you like, rendering server-side, not in the browser.
So I have to be online to read Origin of the Species?
I'm not suggesting this is the only way to do it. I'm just suggesting that if you've got complex formatting and you want to control all sorts of bringing data from lots of different places, it's something that's quite useful in some applications.
Yeah, you know, if you were computing, I don't know, thermodynamic codes, then it might be useful. But, you know, the layout isn't that hard anymore in terms of CPU time.
But the layout might use those thermodynamic codes.
Yeah, I suppose.
There's lots of reasons for doing.
Yeah, I suppose. So that's number 5. Anyone have a 6th way of doing this that you think it's a good idea? Here we go. Or.
I'm just kidding. I'd like to know if your website would honor reverse high contrast. And I'd like to hear you talk about the iPad, because it's not an iPad.
Okay.
I'm mixed up about that.
Okay, so are you asking basically about usability concerns I put in my newly designed website for people with vision problems or you know, there are things you can do so get
no,
people...
No. High contrast.
Well, high contrast...
High contrast, will your website...
I have no idea, but we can log in later, you can tell. You know, it was mostly about shape and size. I certainly am a believer in black letters on a white background sort of presentation, and that's what I would want on my website.
I'm a believer in green letters on a black background. And what do you have to say?
Is that high contrast? That's hard to read, and it would get the typographer in my brain. You know, it's like yellow on white, which I've seen someone make me do. You're saying green on black is high contrast?
High contrast number two, Windows 7.
Okay. That sounds unreadable to me, but I would have to look at it and judge for myself. I am, after all, a typography snob.
Let's not get bogged down. Talk about the iPad.
Okay, the iPad. Yeah. The iPad, I got the Wi-Fi version. I don't need the 3G. I have a 3G for the phone. I load it up in the morning. It has a Wall Street Journal app, which is almost as good as getting ink on your fingers. It's really quite good. I think I spend more time reading the paper now than I did with the paper one. When I have, the paper's still getting delivered, so we're not saving any money. But when I get the paper and the iPad, I'm reading the iPad, mostly because it's newer and cooler. But, I'm not sure. I think it's good enough that it may make a difference for newspapers. For books, it's terrific. It's a great way to cruise the net and read your email. It's not a terminal. I do know Charlie Strauss is now typing some of his books into an iPad, but he prefers some of their interface issues he's got with it. So I'm pretty happy with it. It's pretty cool, and it's a nice form factor. And I like to be able to read stuff in better format than the iBooks and the Kindle, which was one of the reasons I said, ooh, I gotta do this talk. Is there anyone else? Go ahead, sure, we've got time, right? Yeah. Yes, I sure you would.
Can I write more on my iPad?
Steve Jobs is very particular about non-App Store apps. There's someone at work, well, we have a site license for doing enterprise development of stuff, and it's only allowed to run on 100 items, so we filled that up. So a colleague of mine spent $100 to become a developer, and this is one of the 100 devices that he has permitted to use his apps. So the answer is no. However, if this is worth cleaning up a little and putting in free on the iPad store, I'm willing to do it. I'm also, officially, of course, this is AT&T code and I have to get it released, but it's possible that the application might magically appear someplace if you ask nicely, along with my hacked up other things. You know, if it makes this work, that's fine. And actually, I could get approval to do that, I think, without much trouble. If you wanted to give it a try, or if you're actually good at an iPad app, my guess is if you're actually good at these apps, you could take what I've done and in the morning be way ahead with, you know, all the sort of sexy Apple transitions. It doesn't take that much to make them work. You just have to know in salt of sea. I'm sorry, speak up.
If it follows the precedent that's been set on the iPhone, I don't think you'll ever see tech on it. Tech is a programming language.
But are they worried about Macromedia Flash being implemented in tech? I know it's Turing complete, but really? That's an interesting point, I suppose. And it might make Steve think for a little while. I don't know how they do it. Of course, my app doesn't do that. It just displays bitmaps, so I don't think they care. I think they'd love it as another thing to do. Anyone else? Okay, I'll be around the rest of the day. I'd love to hear what you have to say.